MedCram.com.
Well, welcome to another MedCram lecture. We're going to go over an EKG, and I've seen that so many of you are finding these practice EKGs helpful, especially those of you who have gone through the EKG course that's available on our website, that this is really just the cherry on top. It's the icing. It is the practice that solidifies all of the principles that we learn in the EKG class. So I really encourage those of you who can to go over to the website and look at the EKG course where we go through all of this. What we're going to do here is go through our methodical method of interpreting EKG so we can pick up all of these things and make a diagnosis. And as we all know, practice makes perfect. So what we're going to do first is we're going to go over the methodology here, and that is this order of rate, rhythm, axis, hypertrophy, and looking at ST segments. So let's first of all look at the rate on this EKG. So the first thing that I want you to notice specifically here is at the bottom, we can see here is the criteria for what is set. The speed of the EKG is at 25 millimeters per second, which is pretty standard. What's not standard is the 20 millimeters per millivolt. And you can see here that that standardization box is about twice as high as it would normally be. So just keep that in mind and be aware of that. So the first thing that we want to do is look at the rate. Now, just by looking at this EKG, you can tell right off the bat that the spaces between the QRS complexes at the beginning are different than at the end. So there may be a rhythm change. And anytime where there's sort of this irregularity, remember that this is a 10-second strip. So because there are six 10-second periods in a minute, we can just simply count these up, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 21, 22, 23, and multiply that by 10. So if we have 23 QRS complexes and we multiply that by 6, since there are 6 10-second periods in a minute, we're going to get something that's close to about 138 beats per minute. Okay, so that would be the average for the whole EKG. Now, if we go back and look a little bit more carefully, we can actually do a little bit different methodology. We'll look here at the beginning, and you can see clearly here that we're dealing with one, two, three, approximately three boxes. And you know that the first box is 300, and the second box is 150, and the third box is 100. So the distance between here and here would lead you to believe that we're dealing with about a rate of 100, okay? Whereas over here, you can see that the number of boxes in between each is about two boxes, and so what we're dealing with here is about 150. So 150 means that we went from 100 to about 150, and as you can tell, as we'll get into a little bit later, we may have gotten into an irregular rhythm, but let's keep an eye on that. So I think here, overall, we went from about 100 to 150 based on the boxes, but the average, looking at all of the beats, would be 23 times 6, which is about 138. So that would be the average, about 138 beats per minute. So that's the rate, the ventricular rate. Okay, let's look at rhythm next. So for rhythm, we're looking at P waves and QRS complexes. And we're also looking at seeing how regular things are. You can see here at the beginning, things generally speaking are pretty regular. Whereas here at the end, we've got some irregularity. You can see here, for instance, the distance between here is a little bit different than the distance between here. There seems to be a speeding up. And I think what you may see here, if you look very carefully, is some P waves there. And then there may be some in here and also in here. Or it could be just the end of the QRS complex. If there is, there's definitely a distance between these two, and it's almost getting to be a first degree heart block. Certainly here one could make the argument about that. Either this is a speed up here and this goes into a, like, intermittent atrial fibrillation with sinus rhythm. Here I think one can definitely make the argument that we are definitely in a sinus rhythm here at the beginning. But in terms of the rate, you can see here that certainly the distance here is different than the distance here. So we may be dealing with an intermittent atrial fibrillation versus a fluctuating sinus tachycardia. And I know that later, after this patient had this EKG, the patient did go into atrial fibrillation. So again, I think what we can say here is we certainly started out in sinus, but it ended up going into atrial fibrillation, although it's not particularly clear on that. Okay, next is axis. So what I like to do with axis, and I'll pick a different color here so you can see, is there's a number of techniques that you can use. One of the techniques is looking at these limb leads and picking out the one, in this case it's Roman numeral 1, that is the highest positive amplitude. And that's going to be the one that is going to have the direction that most likely goes along with the axis. So because the vector Roman numeral 1 is in this direction, that's going to be the direction, generally speaking, of the axis. Now, that could also mean that since AVF is going down, that it should be the most isoelectric. And in fact, that's exactly what we see, is here in AVF, we're seeing the least amplitude. So therefore, the axis has to be most in line with lead Roman numeral 1 and perpendicular to lead AVF, since that has the lowest amplitude out of all of them. So let's see what that would look like. It would look like then that the vector would have to be going in this direction. Why is that? Because it's most in line with Roman numeral 1 and it's perpendicular to AVF. So if that's the case, if we were to look at, for instance, Roman numeral 2 or even 3, if the vector is in fact going from left to right on the page, but actually left axis deviation because we're looking at the patient, then it should be negative in Roman numeral lead 3 and positive in Roman numeral lead 2, right? Because it's going generally in the same direction as 2, but it's going the opposite direction as 3. So let's take a look and see if that's in fact the case. And sure enough, we see in Roman numeral lead 3, we have a negative deflection. And in Roman numeral 2, we have a positive deflection. So that makes sense. We also see a relatively positive deflection in AVL. Now, why would that be? Again, looking at this, AVL goes in this direction. And that's almost generally speaking the exact same direction as the vector that we're proposing. So I believe here that some perturbation of this is going to be your axis going from, basically it's almost a left axis deviation, a slight left axis deviation. Okay, so we got rate, rhythm, and we got axis. Let's look for hypertrophy. Now, hypertrophy is tricky, as you'll know. Well, let's look back here, and there's four chambers of the heart. Let's go through them. There's the right atrium, the left atrium, the right ventricle, and the left ventricle. So if we're looking for right atrial enlargement, the big thing that we look for is two things. Number one, we look for peaked T waves in Roman numeral lead 2, and we don't see that. And also here in V1, we look for a large upward deflection and a small downward deflection. That would be right atrial enlargement, and we don't see that here. The other thing that you'd see for left atrial enlargement is a small positive and a large negative deflection in the P wave. We don't see that either. So we don't see any evidence for right atrial or left atrial enlargement. What about right ventricular hypertrophy? So right ventricular hypertrophy, remember, is you're going to look back at lead V1 and you're going to be looking for an R wave that's bigger than an S wave. Clearly here the S wave is bigger, so there's no evidence of right ventricular hypertrophy. Let's look at left ventricular hypertrophy, and the criteria for that is the number of millimeters here. It's the S wave in lead V1, and here you can see that we're talking about, oh, I don't know, about 6 or 7. Okay, we're going to come back to that later because we're not done with that number 6, and I'll show you why. It's a little tricky. And then we're looking in lead V5 specifically for a R wave. And the R wave here is what? 5, 10, probably 12 millimeters. So 12 millimeters. However, remember, don't get fooled. It's 20 millimeters per millivolt. We're actually really adding at millivolt. So we really, since we're stretching this out with this calibration, we really need to add this up and divide it by 2. So that would be 18 divided by 2 is 9. So this is essentially 9 millivolts total is the S wave in V1 and the R wave in V6. And so 9 millimeters is far short of the 35 millimeter criteria for left ventricular hypertrophy. So we don't see any of the four chamber enlargement. We don't see right atrial enlargement, left atrial enlargement, right ventricular hypertrophy, or left ventricular hypertrophy. So we can check that off. The next and last thing we go to here is ST segments. And I think that's really where the key is for those of you who have kind of looked ahead on this. We're seeing big time ST segment elevation here in 2. We're also seeing it in V2. We're seeing it in V3. We're seeing it in V4. We're seeing it in V5. We're seeing it in V6. Also in lead 3. We're seeing a bit of it in lead AVF as well, but not to the same degree. We're seeing it all over the place. It's not in any one particular distribution. So you've got to be careful, because when you see global ST segment elevation all throughout the leads, the one big thing that you've got to think about in this situation is definitely pericarditis. Pericarditis is an important diagnosis to make because its very close cousin alternative diagnostically on the EKG is a myocardial infarction. Now, in some of these centers that can't do angiography within 90 minutes, they have to give TPA. You don't want to give TPA to someone with pericarditis, because if you've got bleeding into the pericardium, that can very quickly turn into tamponade, which is obviously life-threatening. And so you want to give TPA to those that you think have an occlusion in the coronary artery, and you definitely do not want to give TPA to someone with pericarditis. Both of those will have ST segment elevation. One will be global, as in pericarditis. The other one will be segmental, either 2-3 AVF for inferior, or it will be V1, V2 for an anterior, or it'll be V4, 5, and 6 for a lateral. Okay, so I think what we've got here is pericarditis with a heart rate of 138, sinus / atrial fibrillation with a mild left axis deviation and no signs of hypertrophy. And that is the EKG. Join us for more EKGs to go over, as you know, because practice makes perfect. Thanks for joining us.